Okay, thank you very much, and thank you very much for having me again. I will start sitting, and probably later on I will walk around, but still walking from the hotel to here was a very oppressive weather. It reminds me of Tel Aviv in the most humid days in the year, where you walk and you sweat. And I saw that Budapest will be different, but probably today it's the same, it's similar. Okay, let me begin, and I will try to make it as leisurely as possible, and if we have discussions, I'll be glad about it, and I'll begin by telling you what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to change the order of the topics that are being presented on the program. I'm not going to talk on victimhood in the morning. I'm going to talk about models of reconciliation and then victimhood later on, because of the simple fact that the concept of reconciliation is more inclusive. So it's a general topic, and victimhood comes under it as one point, but it's not the only point. Victimhood is very important for reconciliation, but we'll talk about it somewhat later. And I would like to begin by saying a few words about myself, where I'm coming from to the topic of reconciliation. Yesterday's talk, I remember talk about anti-Semitism. There was the point made that a researcher should be aware of the place he or she are coming to study a topic. And since we're not dealing with physics, we're dealing with human affairs in psychology and social psychology, so I think it would be best if I begin by telling you something about myself and the place I am coming to this topic. I began dealing with the topic of reconciliation and conflict basically about 15, a little bit more than that, years ago. Until then, my whole career, and still is now in many ways, was devoted to the social psychology of altruism, the social psychology of helping relations, and I'm still doing that kind of research and thinking about. But about 15 years ago, I was asked to establish a research institute at Tel Aviv University, together with the Paris Center for Peace, under the name of the Institute for the Study of Diplomacy and Regional Cooperation, which was basically about conflict, about the conflict in the Middle East and other conflicts as well. So I became acquainted with the topic of conflict between groups, about which I was very interested, because all my life I've been living in the Middle East, and in Israel we know that that place I've been living under the shadow of conflict all my life, and also being a second generation of Holocaust survivors. Both my parents were Holocaust survivors. None of my family members made it. These were the only two people who made it after the Second World War. The topic of conflict was always very much at the center of my being, if you will. So when I went to establish that institute, and I began to look at the area of conflict, of social psychology of conflict, because I'm a social psychologist, I discovered that the model of conflict at that time was very simplistic. You've been talking yesterday, I think, or the day before yesterday, about the model of real conflict theory, okay, real conflict approach. This was it. Why conflict? Simply because there are not enough resources in the world. Groups want resources, they want land, they want water, they both want it, and therefore there is conflict. Very simplistic, very simple approach. So there is a real conflict, and once there is a real conflict over resources, people in two groups begin to develop prejudices and other kind of negative negative phenomena about each other. This was the reigning model in the social sciences. It came to us basically, I think, much influenced by economics, by game theory. And when you talk and you look at the literature in the 70s, 80s, and even 90s, in, for example, political science and international relations, they talk about two actors, okay? They talk about two actors having divergent interests. These are not people. These are not groups with thoughts, beliefs. These are actors, neutral concept, for a neutral approach about what conflict is all about. So this is what I met, and then I realized that at least in my life, in the region in which I live, there are other things. There are things like respect, humiliation, honor, forgiveness, apology. And when I began to look at the literature at that time for related concepts, for example, it was the beginning, the days where the computerized search was beginning to be very sophisticated, and I put down the word forgiveness or apology or reconciliation. And what came up were journals like Psychology and Christianity, Pastoral Psychology, Religion and Psychology, okay? So serious, quote-unquote, scientists, quote-unquote, social psychologists, did not deal with these concepts about 15 years ago. They viewed conflict as being merely a conflict over conflicted interests. And the way to solve a conflict of conflicting interests is very simple. You take two relatively rational negotiators who need to negotiate some kind of an optimal formula to divide the resources between themselves. Again, it's an economic approach to conflict. It's a calculus of interests. You give me that, I give you that. And in exchange, we give each other that. So there's a lot of literature, very important literature, by the way, about how to negotiate and how to resolve conflicts with this type of approach. But there's almost nothing, at least at that time, about the emotional identity-related aspects that keeps group fighting each other, individuals fighting each other. Before I go into the models themselves, let me just preface and say that I do not see many differences between individuals and groups. I do not see too many differences in reconciliation between a man and a woman who have fallen out, one betrayed the other. I think reconciliation in that regard obeys the same basic psychological processes, and I hope I'll be able to convince you in a short while, the same basic psychological processes that also operate in relations between Israelis and Palestinians. Respect, honor, and power are general concepts. The need for revenge works on the individual, on the end, on the intergroup level. So what I'm going to present or talk about shortly is a general understanding of processes of reconciliation. But I'm going to focus on intergroup reconciliation because this is the focus of what we are going to talk about today. Okay. Let me say a few words about the history of the concept of reconciliation. Now I'm getting into the topic itself of models of reconciliation. Let me say a few words about the history of the concept. In 1539, the Oxford Dictionary of English defined reconciliation as the returning to use a church property that had been desecrated, that had been vilified. Okay, so your reconciliation is basically something that has been vilified by one way or another, and you make a blessing over it, and you can use it in church again, and now there's reconciliation. So this concept has a religious, like many of our other concepts, has a religious underpinning, a religious roots, but it talks about, as we move along, and I won't go into the whole history of the concept, but it talks about basically mending relationships. So for the time being, reconciliation for us is the process of taking broken relationships and putting them back together again. In human affairs, in our daily life, we do it through what I will talk about in much more detail later. We deal with, how do we do it? By apologizing and forgiving. So if I did something wrong, I come to you, I say, I did something wrong, forgive me. And then you say, okay, I forgive you, and relationships, in a systematic manner, relationships are all back together again. Okay? So it's the process of mending relationships, and if we talk about the concept of reconciliation from a very general perspective, it doesn't matter what the relationships are. It may be a relationship between God and myself, between me and my church or my synagogue, or it can be between two people. It's taking something that has been broken in relationship and mending it, making it all together again. Now, the concept of reconciliation for many years has not been, as I told you earlier, a subject of study within social psychology or scientific theory in general in the social sciences. By we I mean economists, sociologists, political scientists, psychologists, all social scientists wanted to think about ourselves as serious scientists. So we don't deal with the soft matter of forgiveness, of emotions. This, by the way, has changed dramatically. And as anyone who does social psychology knows, in the past 15 years, these are the main topics within social psychology. But this was not the case about 15 years ago. Nevertheless, Goffman, whose name you must know, deals with the concept of reconciliation in 1971, and he writes about what does an apology mean? What is an apology? When I apologize to you, what do? And he calls it a splitting of the self. I'm taking the self, which is me, and I'm telling you, there are two of me. There's the one who did wrong, but there's the real me, who is a good person. So Goffman regards the process of reconciliation, of apology, as a splitting of the self. And moving right along, in 1991, a person by the name of Tavuchis, a social psychologist in sociology, wrote what is still today, I think, and I'm mentioning the name because anyone who wants to may want to have a look at that book. It's a small book, but very fascinating. A book in 1991 called Mea Culpa. It's my fault, I apologize. In which, I think he's the first one to attempt a brilliant analysis of what reconciliation is all about. Okay, and he talks about what I'm going to talk about, the wonder, the miracle that happens in relationships when by words you change reality. When by saying, please forgive me, and by receiving, okay, I forgive you, you change your conflict to reality. So this miracle of the apology forgiveness cycle, which I will spend some time talking about, is the other step in the history of the concept. And now we're getting to more recent analysis of the concept of reconciliation, especially in intergroup relations. And I will not go further into that, but just offer you first of all, indicate a problem when we talk about reconciliation. And the problem is that when I say reconciliation, I mean at the same time an outcome and a process. Okay? When I say the groups are reconciled, I'm talking about an outcome, a new social reality. Instead of conflict, there is a social reality of social harmony. But it's also a process. How do I go there? How do I get there to social harmony from conflict? I'm going to focus on concept, but let me just offer you one definition of the outcome of reconciliation, which I think is important because it talks about three different aspects of reconciliation. I forgot my red dot thing, but nevertheless. You have one? Yes, it's Tavuchis, Tavuchis, 1991.
This one?
Okay, if we talk about now and I want to put it aside, the concept of reconciliation as an outcome, it is made up of three elements or three aspects. When I say that two groups are now reconciled, the outcome of reconciliation had been achieved, I'm talking about how do I go back?
This one.
Oh, it's so simple.
You are here, and that's the point.
Okay, that's the pointer. Okay. Okay, when I talk about two groups that are now reconciled, I'm talking about three different elements. In conflict, the relationships were destroyed. There was no trust. I will use the example of Israelis and Palestinians because it's close to home, but it's good for any other group in conflict. So the relations have been destroyed. And the social structure in which they exist is unequal in the Middle Eastern social structure. There's inequality. Israelis are better equipped, better technologically, better whatever, economically, than Palestinians. There is a structure of inequality. And the identities, and that will be, that's the main interest of mine, their identities are threatened all the time. As I will talk about in more detail shortly, Israelis feel that Palestinians want to throw them out. They don't accept them. They don't accept their history. They say that the Holocaust never happened. And Israelis similarly feel that the Palestinians are not a nation. They're just, and I'm talking in generalities, they're just another group of Arab people, and they disregard their history. When Palestinians say that the creation of the State of Israel in 1948 was my disaster, we Israelis don't want to listen. We deny it. Okay, so there's an issue of threatened identities on both sides, which plays a very major role. Palestinians actually try to vilify Israelis by saying they are guilty of war crimes, and that's a threat to identity. when you tell me that I'm guilty. Israelis, on the other hand, also threaten Palestinian identity. So identities in conflict are threatened by each side. Equality, as I said before, is unequal, and relations are destroyed. So reconciliation as an outcome, and is what's written up there. I will not even read it. You can read it. But the emphasis is that an outcome of reconciliation must consist of changes on all three dimensions: social structure, relations, and identities. In South Africa, some of the critics of the TRC process say, okay, they try to deal with the identity aspect by the Truth and Reconciliation Committee. They try to deal with the relations. But we still live in an unequal structure. And that's a major part of the problem in post-apartheid South Africa of today. But nevertheless, if we talk about an outcome of reconciliation, this is the outcome. And now we move to the second. And okay, now I want to make a further distinction between two types of reconciliation, and then say that I'm going to focus on one type of reconciliation. The model of reconciliation I'm going to talk about shortly is one type. Okay, we make a distinction between instrumental and socio-emotional reconciliation. I will do it relatively briefly, so that I hope we can have some time later on to discuss and hear your comments and thoughts and objections and agreements about what I've said. So there are two types of reconciliations. Reconciliation goes beyond, for the present purpose, the process of reconciliation goes beyond conflict settlement. That's what we do. We try to settle conflicts. Okay, when two parties sit together, Greece and the European nations now. Okay, they don't deal with issues of respect, which I think is the major problem with the current economic crisis in Greece. They deal with trying to reavert an economic settlement, which will basically leave the problem of lack of respect that the Greeks feel that the Germans treat them by intact. It will not be touched upon. And the relations will also not be a focus of discussions. It will be settling the conflict, arriving at an economic settlement. We go beyond that. There are two kinds of reconciliation when we go beyond settlement of conflict. The first one is instrumental, and it's very much related to the fact that because of conflict, let me make the distinction between these two kinds, instrumental and socio-emotional, from a different point of view. From the instrumental point of view, if you ask somebody, why does a conflict exist? Why are these two groups or two individuals attack each other all the time? The instrumental point of view focuses on relationships, and the answer will be because there's a lack of trust between these two people. There's no trust, and the relations are very bad. So to solve the conflict, what you have to do? You have to rebuild trust and improve relations. Improve relations so that I will not have negative stereotypes about you, you will not have negative stereotypes about me, and so on and so forth. And how do you do that? You do that with what many social scientists have been earning their living from, with dialogue groups of all kinds and forms. You get the two people together, you get them to talk, you get them to do stuff together, things together. You must have heard about the superordinate goal approach, okay, that you create a common goal. And basically what you say in instrumental reconciliation is the following, and now I'm moving to the real world. If Israelis and Palestinians, or Serbs and Croats, cooperate for a fairly long time, okay, they build hospitals together for a common goal, they will learn to trust each other. They will learn that the other is not a devil, but the other also a human being. So most programs of peace building, including the Oslo process in the Middle East and the community building projects in the former Balkans, and I was fortunate enough to be very close to both processes. Most processes of peace building and community building are based on this principle. Give two groups a common goal, have them cooperate to achieve that common goal. Let's call the common goal a new hospital, okay, that will serve both communities. Have them cooperate to build this new hospital. It will take 2 or 3 years. And after some time, they will know that the other party is not really an enemy. He's a human being like myself. I can trust him. I will change my perceptions of them. This is an instrumental reconciliation. It focuses on the relationships between the two parties. As you may notice, I haven't said even one word while describing the process about identity, about feelings, about pride, about respect. Not even one word. It focuses on relationships. It's a process of trust building between two former enemies. When the Oslo process or the Oslo agreements were signed in 1993 and in 1995, basically, when the agreements were signed, this was exactly a process of instrumental reconciliation. It said the following: Israelis and Palestinians will cooperate for 5 years. We'll build projects together, and 5 years later, we'll be ready to move to the second stage of two states and blah, blah, blah. Nothing happened, as you know. Okay, so the process is a process that is a long-term process that is built on mutual cooperation. Now, the socio-emotional path of reconciliation is different. It doesn't talk about relationships at all. It talks about identities and feelings of each of the parties. It talks about the need to remove the urge to take revenge of the other party, to feel secure in who you are. It talks about basically, and there's a very big assumption here, that conflicts continue because each of the parties is threatened. Their identity is threatened. They have feelings of humiliation. They are humiliated. And as long as that happens, you cannot solve the conflict. You have to fix the identities of each party in order for the conflict to really be resolved. Okay, so it's a completely different approach. And as an example, I'm here referring to, is there anyone in the room who doesn't know the process of the TRC or hasn't heard about it in South Africa? The Truth and Reconciliation Committee? I'm assuming that everybody knows about it. Is this a process of socio-emotional reconciliation or instrumental reconciliation? Does it deal with the identities or does it deal with the relations? What's the focus of the post-apartheid TRC? Truth and Reconciliation Committee. The identity.
No, relations.
The relations? Why?
Because it was two parties, like, you know, the community was sort of divided. So they were bringing together two commissions and then.
You're right. That's the main goal. That's the goal. But the process is focusing on the relations, on cooperation between the two parties, on making them work together somehow. Or does it focus on each party's sense of hurt and pride? I agree with you that that was the goal, bring them together, very much so. But anyone else? Both of you are right. You are right in terms of the goal of building better relations between the two separate communities, but the process focuses on exactly what you're saying. Can I forgive? You know, there's very impressive movies and documentaries about the process. One of them, again, I'm reminded, so I'll say it in case anyone wants to view it, A Long Day Journey into Night, in which you see a South African black woman who meets the person who killed her son. Now, in the committee, and she's asking herself the question, can I forgive him? He killed my son. And she forgives him, only after there's some kind of an emotional outburst. I won't go into the movie, anyone who wants to can view it and really look at it, but the process is basically the following. It says the following. If you tell the truth, it says to the police, the white police officer who tormented young black kids, it tells him, if you say the truth, you will be forgiven. Okay, it's a very different approach than, for example, the Nuremberg trials. The Nuremberg trials took the other approach, the other opposite. It said, the Nazis are individual perpetrators, they did it, and therefore we will take them to court and judge them, execute them, whatever. This is a different approach. If you see what the ultimate outcome of these two models of justice, and that's the main thing. In the TRC model of justice, we include the criminals into our society. In the legal process of Nuremberg, we exclude the criminals from our society. And some, just 1 minute, and some have mentioned that the best thing that has ever happened to Germany was the Nuremberg trials, because it affixed the blame, responsibility for the crimes of the Second World War on individuals, on Nazis, not on Germans. And the distinction between Germans and Nazis was basically institutionalized during the Nuremberg trials, and that what allowed Germany to flourish and be a different Germany, which it is today. So there are two different models of justice making. In legal theory, it's called restorative justice versus retributive justice. In restorative justice, you try to restore relations. You try to include the criminal back into the community. In retributive justice, you punish them. You actually hold them responsible and give the punishment and exclude them from the community. Yes, I'm sorry.
Accept, actually tell the truth and they would have been trying to record it, so it's not like it's an exclusively one model in South Africa, completely different.
If they didn't tell the truth, yes, of course. It was conditional, you're right, because the victims were sitting. That was the major idea. I became interested in the whole topic that I'm talking to you about today when I read about the TRC. I saw that to be the most imaginative, courageous social experiment ever done. When, I remember reading in the newspapers in 1989 that if apartheid was abolished, there would be a bloodshed in South Africa. And later, there was no bloodshed. There are problems, but there's no bloodshed. I tend to think that the TRC process is at least partly responsible for the relatively smooth transition. You cannot move from the past, from the painful past, to a hopeful future unless you do either of two things, exclude or include. The Germans, Nuremberg, excluded the Nazis. We are not Nazis. A Nazi is a subcategory of Germans. The South African took another approach, which is more inclusive, but you're very right. If I was a white officer and came before the community and said that they killed only one person, but other people knew that they killed 10, and I lied, I would go to trial and be judged and sit in jail. So it's a conditional kind of amnesty. Okay, but I wanted to make the differences between, idea behind the socio-emotional reconciliation more palatable and more better understood. And let me refocus before going into again to the socio-emotional process. Let me refocus on the differences between instrumental reconciliation and socio-emotional reconciliation. To make it even more concrete, let me think with you together about the differences between ending a conflict with the Oslo process type of procedure, let's cooperate and change and build trust, or the TRC type of procedure. Tell me the truth and I may forgive you. Okay, and that will improve relationships. There are basically three major differences between the three kinds of, between the two kinds of processes, the target of change, the temporal focus, and the goal. Let me begin. Okay, the target of change I already talked about. The Oslo process was focused on trust, on building trust, on the relations. The process focused on changing the relations between the two parties. The target of change in the socio-emotional process, the TRC, was on the feelings of each of the parties or the identities of each of the parties. So these are two different foci of these two processes. Two very important differences, the temporal focus and the goal. I'll begin with the goal. Almost all, I think all, from what I've checked, all committees of truth and reconciliation committees of the kind that were established in South Africa. There were many of them established in South America, Guatemala, Argentina, Chile, and other places. All these truth reconciliation committees that deal with socio-emotional processes are internal, deal with internal conflicts. They want to make a split society whole again, to integrate the society. It was clear that blacks and whites would have to live together in South Africa. It was clear that the former Peronists and the current Argentinians would have to live together in Argentina. So the process of reconciliation dealt with issues of guilt. Okay, it dealt with issues of identity of each of the parties, of pain that you caused me. It's no wonder that almost all of these processes have the word truth in them as a major concept that deals into reconciliation. But let me just say that processes of instrumental reconciliation, building trust between me and you, are best applied when I want to separate from you. I want to build trust so that we can live together with a border like two good neighbors. I don't need the truth. I just want relations of trust. Processes of socio-emotional reconciliation, that I tell you what I did and you accept it and you forgive me or you don't forgive me, and all of that kind of psychological merrymaking, are when two groups want to reintegrate and live together. Let me give you an example from interpersonal relations. When a husband and wife, okay, one person betrayed the other, went with somebody else, and now they are on the verge of making a decision. And the decision is either to split and get a divorce, or to be a family again, to forgive, to tell the truth, and be a family once more. In the first case, all you need is trust for good coexistence, because we have shared commodities, quote-unquote, children, property, what have you. So we need to build trust in order to be able to coexist next to each other. In the second case, where we want to become a family again, you need to tell me the truth. And I need to decide whether or not I forgive you. So processes of this kind, the socio-emotional processes, are related to social integration. Building trust and coexistence is related to social separation. So Israelis and Palestinians, I will finish with that. If we want to have a stable, trustworthy relations with a Palestinian state, we don't need to talk about the past. We need to build trust. We need to build a good neighborly border. But if I'm talking about relations of Israeli citizens, so Palestinian-Israeli citizens, Israeli Arabs, who make up 20% of the Israeli population, with them we need to talk about the past. With them, I need to tell them, yes, Tel Aviv University, my university, is built on the ruins of a village, Sheikh Munis, a major village that existed there before 1948. We need to address the past where we want to reintegrate. We don't need to address the past where we want to separate. These are two major differences that we may want to keep in mind. And with all that, I'm moving further. How do I do it? Oh. Okay. What?
Is it possible to ask questions? Yes,
of course. What was asking? Yes, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm in. It's very inspiring.
What?
It's very inspiring. It's very good. I have two questions. The first one is regarding the model. The question about who's right and who's wrong, who's legitimate, who's not, is not asked.
No. It's
not a question.
But that's the main source of territory. When you deny my legitimacy, you deny me. Okay? And that's what's happening a lot in Israel's Palestinian. And that's the battle who is speaking.
talk about it much more detail. But you're right, legitimacy is a major issue.
And second, you mentioned the neural process.
What?
The neural process against the next. How about the actual process in this one, which was very important, even for the to give the leadership
predictions? I think you're right. They haven't thought about it in this way, but I think you're right. I think in the same way that now also Israelis, you think about Germans as not doing justice. And also facilitate the process. Actually, when you know, in discussions about what happened in Israel, can you hear me when I talk like that?
What?
No.
But in Israel, the Eichmann process is being regarded as a major turning point in the history of the society, because at that point in time, we decided to be normal, quote-unquote. We began to talk about our pains. Before 1961, and I remember that as a young child, I remember people who were Holocaust survivors, the sufferings were not dealt with by the Israeli society. They were not allowed to tell the story. The story was not believed to. But I will talk about it more when I talk about victimhood, but you're very right. It's similar in many ways. Okay. Yeah.
So, you were talking about these two mothers.
Can you help me? How do I get it back? Here I am. Okay, good. Answer.
Yeah. So, that you apply a different process when you separate and a different process when you integrate. But you, in the case of Israel, I gather many of the cases because groups cannot be separated in a sterile way. There are mechanisms such as mass population transfers, and we know they exist. But in case you do not apply these mechanisms, you will have to combine the two processes. You have to, and then conflict is interact.
You're very right. I think the two Palestinian communities that the two Israelis have to deal with differently. There's a Palestinian community that we live outside the borders. Okay, if there is a border, something, 1967 border.
And the 1967 border is such that east of the 1967 border there is Palestine, and west of the 1967 border there is Israel. Okay? These are two separate entities. Okay, we do not consider ourselves one. We are separate. We are neighbors. We need to cooperate. We need to coexist. But we don't need to form a unit relationship. We don't need to be together. Therefore, if I begin, I will make it even more extreme. If I begin to talk about the past with the new Palestinian Authority, with the new Palestinian state, I may actually harm the relationship, the possibility for coexistence. The issue of the Oslo process, I'm getting back to that, and the concept of coexistence actually says, let bygones be bygones. We don't worry about the past. We only think about the future. We think about the present and the future. We don't think about issues of who is responsible for doing what. This is the, if you will, the prescription for coexistence, for trust. But if you want to form a unity relationship with Palestinians who live in Israel, who are part of us, with them you have to talk about the past.
Yes, but the thing is, so my question is that obviously all Palestinians belong together. So your communication with the state is a future state in Palestine will have a message for the Palestinians who live in Israel. They might feel wronged that, you know, how could I integrate in this peace process? They don't address.
Okay. I see what you're saying, that you may be right, but I tell you what my prediction is, and we're talking about predictions we don't know. I think that the more Israelis talk with Arabs living in Israel about the past, and don't talk about the same past with Palestinians living outside Israel, the more they will integrate the Israeli Arabs into the Israeli society. The more they will be able to say, yes, we have unit relationships with you, but not with you. But you know, it's... okay. Yeah. I will leave it at that at this point. Okay. Now I'm going to... What am I doing here? Okay, this one. Okay, now I'm going to present to you the model that we've been working with and some data, very small data. All this work has been done with my former student, current colleague, Noah Schnabel, who basically did her PhD dissertation on the model. And the model says the following. Okay, and here we come to the major point. In conflict, the victims and perpetrators, some have done wrong and some have suffered. I open a parenthesis and I close it. It's true for theoretical purposes, it's not true in the real world. In the real world, in most cases, we are both victims and perpetrators. Okay, some conflicts are very clear. Nazis and Jews, Hutus and Tutsis and Rwandans, it's very clear who is the victim and who is the perpetrator. There's a consensus. In most conflict, it's more murky. It's less clear, but I will get back to this point later. Now, for theoretical purposes, let's talk about victims and perpetrators. It is not true, and that's the first assumption, that victims and perpetrators have the same psychological needs. They have different psychological needs. Different parts of their identities have been damaged because of the conflict. There's a very famous psychological theory by a personality psychologist called Bakan, B-A-K-A-N, who actually told us one very simple thing, that human beings are driven by two basic psychological needs. The need for communion, to be together, and the need for agency, to be alone, independent, and strong. The process of growing up can be viewed as a process of from communion, I and the mother, I and the family, I myself, from communion to agency. And all of us have these two basic needs within ourselves. Perpetrators suffer a threat to their need for communion, for the sense of being accepted by others. Victims suffer a threat to their sense of agency, to the threat of being able, independent, self-controlling. Let me say a few more words about these different threats for victims and perpetrators. When you're a victim, you are powerless. Victims are powerless. Their fate is determined by somebody else. He does or she does things to them. So you feel powerless. The major threat to your identity is the threat to your feeling of being in control, of being powerful, of being independent, all of those things together. That's when you are a victim, when somebody else does things to you. When you're a perpetrator, the major threat that you suffer is a threat to your sense of acceptance. When, again, let me take a very real example close to home. When Israel is being faced with the danger of being excommunicated from the family of nations, its sense of acceptance is being threatened. When somebody in the village, the community, did some bad things, and he or she sense that people will look at them as immoral and will exclude them, their sense of acceptance is being threatened. So perpetrators, the authors of wrongdoings, those who did bad things, suffer a threat to their sense of inclusion. I'm using a sentence, I think Tabuchis has used it. They face the danger of being excluded from the moral community to which they belong. Each one of us belongs to a moral community, to a community that shares values together. It's not said, it's not written, but we know it. When we do something against that community that is inconsistent with the values of this community, we face the danger of being excluded, not accepted. So perpetrators feel a danger to the sense of inclusion in the communities they care about. How is that danger related to conflict? Why would that be related at all to inability to reconcile? Because people and groups are actively doing things to deal with these two dangers: victims to their sense of agency, power, self-control, and perpetrators to their sense of acceptance, inclusion, communion. They do things individually which are very, very good for them, but very good for their relationships. What do victims do to restore their sense of power? They take revenge. Revenge is very healthy. Psychologically, when you take revenge, restore your sense of power. You did something to him or to her. You take revenge, it's very healthy for the individual, for the victim, but it's very bad for the relationships, because my revenge is, in your eyes, is the unjustified aggression that must be avenged. And here goes the cycles of revenge that we are also well familiar with. So victims unilaterally, when you do something by themselves, they can solve the problem. They take revenge. And the history of the Middle East and the history of other places like the former Balkans is the history of revenge. Okay, you hurt me. I'm not as powerless as you think. I will show you. Okay, and you take revenge and you build your image, but you ruin the relationships. Perpetrators do something even worse than revenge. They do what Bandura calls acts of moral disengagement. Bandura, in 1999, wrote a very influential article about moral disengagement, the way in which we disengage ourselves, we distance ourselves from the bad things that we do. And perpetrators do that. They distance themselves from the wrongdoing that they have committed. They may say something like, they may distance themselves from the consequences of their actions and say something like, is that suffering? Is what I did to you caused any pain? That's nothing. They belittle the consequences of their actions. They can evade responsibility for what they did. Well, yes, I had to do it because you started. Okay, it's not my responsibility, it's yours. They take all kind of cognitive steps to belittle and to avoid the label of I am immoral. I am moral because you started it. I am moral because I didn't do anything very bad to you. So I keep being moral. The problem with acts of moral disengagement of the sort that I'm describing is that acts of moral disengagement prepare the ground for the next aggression. If you started it, I can go on. If what I do is nothing, I can do it again. If the Jews are part of an international monetary scheme to control the world, it's their fault. If whatever, you can put whatever group, but once you morally disengage from what you do, you can keep doing it. Okay, so the problem with these threats to identity, which I mentioned earlier, and that this is important for me to convey, is that these are not neutral threats. They continue the conflict. They are the grounds from which the conflict goes on. And let me now, before I move to the next slide, go back to the concept of apology-forgiveness cycle. Why is an apology-forgiveness cycle so effective? Sometimes, not always. When my apology is genuine and I receive your forgiveness, relationships are transformed. Why? What's the source of the effectiveness of the apology-forgiveness cycle? What's the miracle that Abuchis talk about? Yes.
Very much so. Exactly.
Exactly as was being said here. Your name?
As Karin was saying, exactly like that. When I apologize to you, I am giving you the power to forgive or not. The power relations are transformed. Suddenly the victim becomes the powerful party in the relationship. And when I, the victim, forgive, then the perpetrator, when I forgive the perpetrator, what happens to them in terms of their feeling of acceptance, inclusion? Yeah, they're part of it again, they're part of me. Okay, everything is good. Let's continue. So in other words, when we talk about the social exchange, when the perpetrator gives power, quote unquote, to the victim, and the victim reciprocates by giving acceptance, this is the psychological mechanism, at least one that is suggested, behind the miracle that Abuchis talk about, the revolution of social relationship. Yes. Yes.
When, for example, South Africa, where the deal was, you told you do not do that, how much more is it an apology if it's issued, because otherwise something worse would happen?
A false apology. A false apology and a false forgiveness, basically. I have no one to answer for that. I think it's a danger. I think it's a danger, but still, you know, when you look, you know, for me, when you look at the process, in the movie I just mentioned, by the way, the whole process was televised all over South Africa. And you can tell when a person does that. And there are instances when people say, you don't tell the truth, and you don't tell the truth, or you say what you say because you want to get away from punishment. And there are other instances when people cry on the witness stand.
I don't have an answer for that, but I think you're raising a very good point. And I will get to it as we go to the next part about the differences between genuine and false reconciliation. But basically, if we stay with what I've been saying until now, in the apology forgiveness cycle, when I give you power and you give me acceptance, we're basically being able to heal the identity wounds of each of the parties, okay? And that's the source of reconciliation. This means, now I'm getting to research and saying something more concrete about all of that. Okay, here's what I just said. It's written, so you can read it leisurely. Okay, and this is the model. And let me go with the model and then go to some findings, some extensions, and I will be done with this part of the presentation. Okay, that's what I said until now is basically summarized in this drawing. The identity dimension that is impaired, threatened, for victim is agency, control, power, status. For perpetrator, it's communion, moral image. This increases their motivation, the victim and the perpetrator, to restore the agency dimension that has been threatened, and for the perpetrator to restore the moral social dimension that had been threatened, the communion dimension. This may be achieved by empowerment of the victim by the perpetrator, as in the case, like Karine mentioned earlier, the case of apology. When I apologize, I empower you. And it can, and the dimension of communion is restored by acceptance by the victim. When this occurs, there's a restoration of agency and a restoration of communion or moral social dimension of identity. And here is what one arrow that is missing because it didn't go into the slide. Here, the two arrows and say increased readiness for reconciliation. So there's an implied, very practical implication for what I've been saying. That if you give victims power, they are readier to reconcile. If you give perpetrators communion or acceptance, they're readier to reconcile. Okay, now let me go to some data. No. Okay, I will go to this one. A number of studies, many of them, but I chose to focus on one. The basic idea, I want to put it, you know, I've learned from many, many years of talking to people, students, whatever you, that you have to summarize what you say by one sentence. That when people leave, after they've heard all of these details, they remember something which they can take home with. And the one sentence I would like to summarize what I've been saying until now is, victims are readier to reconcile when empowered. Perpetrators are readier to reconcile when accepted. Okay? Until now, this is the take-home message. There are many other issues and questions and stuff like that, but this is basically. So if we talk here, what we did, Nurit, myself and others, Nurit and others, what we've done, we applied the model to intergroup relations. And we did it in two studies. In the first study, we focused on Arabs and Jews living in Israel. The second study focused on Jews and Germans. In the first study, this is important, in the first study, Jews are the perpetrators, they are the wrongdoers, they did something very bad. In the second study, they are the victims. Germans are the perpetrators. So in the first study, what we did, very basically, we reminded Arabs and Jews, Arab students and Jewish students, reminded them of an historical event that happened, I think, in 1955. Very terrible event, which is known by the name of the Kfar Qasim massacre. It was a young state, the State of Israel. Arabs were under military law, Arab citizens. It was only about 5 or 6 years after the War of Independence had ended. Everything was very raw and very fragile. And a group of Palestinian Israelis, or Israeli Arabs. By the way, Palestinians, when you talk to them, Israeli citizens in Israel, like to call themselves Palestinian Israelis. We call them Israeli Arabs. But I respect their wish, and I call them Palestinian Israelis, because it's their the self-definition that matters. So Palestinian Arabs were coming from the fields, about 50 or more than them, workers coming from the fields. After having worked in the field, it was 5 p.m. in the afternoon. They were stopped by a border patrol, Israeli border patrol. They didn't know about the curfew that had been announced. The Israeli border patrol, to make a long story short, killed, I think, about 34 of them, because they didn't comply with the rules of curfew at that time. So we gave Palestinian Israelis and Israeli Jews a short synopsis of the event so that they can reconnect to the event of being victims or perpetrators. Jews are perpetrators, Arabs are victims. And later on, they received a message of empowerment or a message of acceptance from the other side. A message of empowerment would say something to Palestinian Arabs that they are a strong nation, powerful, dignified, they have the right to determine, so on and so forth. And a message of acceptance was a message that highlighted acceptance, that they are very likable, very nice people, and so on and so forth, okay? And as you can see, that is the main thing. For Palestinian Israelis, the victims, when they had received a message of empowerment, the readiness to reconcile with Israeli Jews is higher. These are significant differences than when they had received the message of acceptance, and vice versa for Israeli Jews. When they receive the message that they are nice and moral and good people, they are ready to reconcile with the Palestinian Arabs than when the message said that they are strong and independent and self-controlling. Why? Because the message was so consistent with the need that they had at that point in time. So this is one way. The second study showed that with Germans and Jews. Again, we had German students and Jewish students as participants. And the same phenomenon. When Jews now are the victims, they all read a section about the Holocaust. When Jews are the victims, message of empowerment made them readier to work on side with Germans than a message of acceptance, a message that you are strong, independent, blah, 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 had better effect than a message of you are nice, etc., etc. And for Germans, it's the other way around, when they were the perpetrators. So in other words, from these two studies, we can deduce two things. It's the social role that matters. It's the same group, Jews, in both cases. Once they are perpetrators, once they are victims. And according to the social role, the different needs are being threatened and fulfilling, meeting those needs increases the readiness for reconciliation, which basically gives support to the model. I will not go into more stuff. Let me just say a few words. I will take about 3 or 5 minutes. 10:30, right? That's okay. 3 or 5 minutes to get to the end and say the following. I think I've sent you, so if anyone is interested, I think you can look at it. I've sent you a chapter that I and Nuri did recently for the European Review of Social Psychology, which summarizes much of the work on the model. And these are three, it's not out yet, it's in press, but you can look at it. And these are three extensions that I will say very briefly something about them. First of all, structure of violence, or Galtung, who is one of the best well-known peace psychologists or peace theoreticians in the world, has made a distinction between direct violence and structural violence. Direct violence is when I kill you. Structural violence is when I discriminate against you. Okay, the difference, the structure violates your rights. Structural violence exists, for example, between African Americans and white Americans in the United States. In any other country, there are groups that are disadvantaged. We extended the model to structural violence, and again, it works also in cases for structural violence. To make it concrete and succinct, white Americans want to be liked. Black Americans want to be respected. Okay, liked is communion, respected is part of agency, to be respected for who you are. That's very basically the statement. Okay, one thing which is important, there's some research that Nurit did with Ilanit, another doctoral student of mine, and they did some research together about the duality, the situation in which you feel both a victim and a perpetrator. You are both. I don't have time to go into that. If you want to, you can read about it more in the chapter. If we can talk about it later, maybe. And one last word about this slide is that, and that's an important point. When I say to you, I apologize. I've done bad things. Please forgive me. I'm doing two things, not one. I'm conveying a message of apology, but I'm also conveying a positive message to you. Okay? I'm saying something positive. We were enemies, and suddenly I come to you with something positive. With something which may increase the trust that we have. To finalize this point, I want to say the following statement, that all this works if there's enough or basic level of trust between the two parties. Because if I say, and that relates to the question that we had earlier, if I say I apologize and you don't trust me, and there's some finding on that, it backfires. You hate me even more. Okay. I know that this last slide was not well. What am I doing? Okay. Okay. The last message on the extensions was not very well explained, but if you want to, you can go into the stuff that I had sent and learn more. I want to finish with this slide because it touches on the bridge between what I said until now and victimhood. Who in this room knows about Jeanne Améry? Okay, Jeanne Améry. Jeanne Améry is a very interesting individual. He was a prisoner in Auschwitz. He got back out of Auschwitz, settled in Germany, and was a very, very strong vocal opponent to the then prevailing tendency in German society to not talk about the Holocaust. I'm talking about the 50s and 60s. I remember meeting German colleagues or friends who told me that their history lessons ended in 1914. They were students in high school in the 1960s. The German society at that time was completely oblivious to the Second World War. Jeanne Améry was a vocal opponent to this tendency, and he talked a lot about the rights of the victim. He said that we live in a society which vilifies victimhood and puts forgiveness on a pedestal. We should forgive, and that is a re-victimization of the victim. Victims have right to be resentful, said Jeanne Améry. They have demands of the perpetrator that should be consummated. Only when their demands have been consummated can they reconcile. Jeanne Améry himself committed suicide in 1989 in Salzburg. He later became one of the, for me, one of the best ever writers, both literature and philosophy. And he does all of that from a position of strength and dignity at the same time, which is something which is not very common. His position on victimhood, I choose to finish with it, because it will be a bridge. I will finish the next talk also with Jeanne Améry, but it's a bridge to the next topic I want to talk about, the topic of victimhood. And with this, it's exactly 10:30. Oh. Okay, I should work at that, okay.